In this episode of Byte Size, we are looking at ports, IRQs, and DMA channels. Stop and think for a minute about how your CPU talks to another piece of hardware. Back in the early days of AT machines, this could be the serial port, disk controller, keyboard controller, or even your beloved shiny new sound card. Just like a human requires the ability to process data and have memories to operate in the real world, we already take for granted that the CPU talks to its memory in order to function. The CPU knows which part of a memory chip it's talking to because each memory location has a unique memory address. So it follows then that other hardware also needs a communication route, a bit like your spinal cord, connecting all the parts of your body and allowing signals from your brain to operate them. But like your body, different components require different routes to connect them. In a PC, these are known as input/output addresses, or port addresses. And like your body, there are fewer port addresses than the addresses connecting up your memory. When the 386 processor was introduced, it could address 4096 megabytes of RAM, but only 64K of port addresses. Port addresses then allow a CPU to identify its various peripherals. The keyboard controller sits at address 64, the serial port at 3F8, and so on, each represented in hex. If the 386 wants to talk to the Ethernet card at port 300, it drops some data down the tube labelled 300, and a dialogue can commence. Usually peripherals take up a range of ports. A CD-ROM drive commonly consumes ports 230 to 233, and one we're all common with, a sound card, usually grabs ports 200 to 22F. Once this port address is established, no other device can use it, and we welcome ourselves into the painful world of conflicts. And before plug and play, we had to deal with these conflicting devices manually. In a basic system, everything usually runs smoothly as all the components have separate and defined addresses, but when adding third-party devices such as Ethernet cards, SCSI adapters or soundboards, we need to make sure that they play nicely. Originally this was done using jumpers on the actual boards to configure their ports, but as the PC evolved, driver software often took over this task, allowing for easier configuration. The only problem with this was when you had two boards using the same port on boot, conflicting before you had a chance to change them in software. If one of these boards operated something crucial, perhaps such as your SCSI hard drive controller, then it would render the other plug-in board essentially unusable, as you'd have to unplug it before booting your computer. Next up, we have direct memory access channels. Now, we can think of DMA a bit like muscle memory in that your memory is communicating directly with your muscles, to say, swing a golf club or whatever you people do. And bypassing your brain's processing. A fundamental problem in computer design is shifting data from memory to a device. The most simple method was often using a PIO, or programmed input-output, with the CPU sending commands via this address, grabbing data from the peripheral, shifting it into memory, and so on. What would be quicker if, after receiving the command from the CPU, the peripheral could just plonk its data into memory itself, without the CPU having to shuffle it about? So a device can send a D-request signal to the DMA controller to ask for direct memory access, and the controller can return a DAC, or acknowledge signal, granting the peripheral a pathway to the memory. The original PC XT model had an 8237 DMA controller chip, allowing up to 4 DMA channels, which is one reason why most sound cards settle for DMA 3 on setup. This limitation stuck with the 8-bit ISA slots into the 90s, along with the original XT DMA operation speed of 4.77 MHz. This led to the original method of DMA dropping out of favour, given its incredibly inadequate speed upon the arrival of processors which could operate at many times this clock frequency. One of the improvements put in place was bus mastering, which, especially in PCI setups, allowed rapid transfer of data directly from peripheral, or directly to RAM. So that leaves us with interrupt request levels, or IRQs. You'll remember I mentioned PIO, or programmed input output, when dealing with peripherals. Well, a CPU usually instigates all the communication with its devices. They don't speak unless spoken to. So, for a peripheral to get the CPU's attention, it can either use polling or interrupts. Polling is essentially the CPU shouting down the address tube, asking the device to do something, and then continually asking that device whether it's finished yet. A bit like a kid asking, "Are we there yet?" and constantly hoping for a yes response from the driver. This is great in a single tasking environment as the CPU doesn't have anything else to do anyway, but when it comes to multitasking, this is an appalling waste of a processor's time. An alternative is assigning an interrupt path between a device and the CPU. Originally, this was handled by an Intel 8259 controller, but was quickly consumed into the motherboard chipset. The 8259 had 8 interrupt levels from 0 to 7, with the lower numbers getting higher priority. When a device assigned with one of these interrupts needed the CPU to do something, it would send a signal down the line and instantly grab the CPU's attention. If there was a queue of devices waiting, then the ones with the lowest IRQ would be given priority. IRQ 0 is an interrupt timer circuit which polls about 18 times per second. IRQ 1 is for the keyboard. This makes sense because when you press a key, you need the CPU to hear you and act upon your key press, and you want that to be a high priority action. Other devices could then make the use of IRQs 2 through 7. The AT machines then brought with them a second 8259 controller, hardwired to IRQ 2, allowing for a further 8 interrupts and much more breathing room. So this combination of manually defined addresses, channels and ports was what allowed many an IBM PC compatible machine to run with many different setups throughout the 80s and 90s. Often they caused a lot of headaches and problems, hence why plug and play was brought into effect, with the idea that the BIOS and operating system would cooperate and work out these ports on our behalf. Although in the early days this was more plug and pray rather than plug and play. Especially when using legacy cards which didn't play ball at all. But for me, I will forever associate this combination most strongly with sound cards. Whenever we set up Doom or Duke Nukem 3D, these three little pieces of information were essential so we could hear those sweet, sweet sound effects. And if we were lucky, we even got some FN synthesis, or wavetable sound if you were really lucky, for good measure as well. Although that often had an address of its own. Anyway, that's all for this Byte Size. If you want to learn about plug and play, check out this video I published last year. In the meantime, you can subscribe, thumb up or down, or even help support me through Patreon for some exclusive rewards. In any case, thank you for watching and have a great evening.